morning.
Amen.
Absolutely beautiful, I know. It's been a little cold. We lost our power Wednesday for a few hours at the house. But when you look out there and you see the beautiful sun shining, the crystal cool air out there, I thank God He's in control. And if you came to church not expecting anything, that's exactly what you're going to get.
Amen.
But if you came to church this morning, those of you that are watching, if you tuned in to us this morning, you're not tuning into us. You're turning into what the Spirit desires to give you this
Amen.
Morning. If you will open up that vessel and say, Lord, I'm here to praise you. I'm here to worship Woo, you this morning. If you came for that reason, and that reason yeah. alone, you expect to be blessed. God is a blessing God. I feel that this morning, that God wants to touch His children. And His children will only say, Lord, at times I played the fool. Oh, how many times, Brother Fletcher, have I played the fool? But that mercy the Lord will tell us through His word. Coming from the 139th Psalm, David wrote this, 14th verse. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows right. Oh, glory to God. You and I are fearfully and wonderfully made. Even though sin did come in, and sin is a stealer, sin is a death, sin is decay, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. And if our trust is in the Lord this morning, you got nothing to worry about.
Amen.
You got nothing to worry about. Because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. Amen.
Amen.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we love you this morning.
And to ask the Lord for His protection,
his favor and blessings over this child's entire life. And as a we're the children of God. We belong to him. And if we do get to preach this morning, then I know it's the Holy Spirit gave me this message. Because our message today is the language of life. The language of faith. This right here is life. Amen. Given by God, breathed by God into this world. So what we want to do is collectively come before the Lord and let's pray. Let's do that right now. Heavenly Father, we bring this sweet, precious soul before you, Lord, and the angels in heaven and all the heavenly hosts. In Jesus' name, Lord, we ask right now. We plead the blood of Jesus over her life. Lord, we dedicate her as a church family unto you. Lord, we make, Lord, a vow before you right now, as the parents and grandparents are here, to do everything in our power to raise this child, to teach this child the ways and admonitions of you, Lord, that Jesus is Savior and Lord, and that the blood, and only the blood, saves. Lord, we ask you to shower this child with blessings of health. Health, oh God. Most of all, spiritual health throughout her life. And that she will be a blessing to all those that come across her path because they will see Christ in her. Father, I ask you to bless the parents, the grandparents, and the great-grandparents. Lord, give them wisdom. Wisdom that only comes from above, that only comes from you, to raise this child as you would have them raise it. We ask all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. And all of God's children said, amen and amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
At the trumpet's call, lift your voices. road, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee.
Worship his holy name.
team gets ready to sing this song. There's some people watching right now. You feel like you're in a corral and you can't get out. You feel trapped and you don't feel like there's no way out. Satan's lied to you. You're looking in a mirror and that's all you see is a reflection of gloom and despair. But I'm here to tell you this morning, if you will place your faith in the Lord God above, and you will begin to praise Him and declare from your heart, your voice is just an extension of what's in your heart, and you will say, how great thou art. If you will just declare it before God, before heaven, before all the angels, before all that's around in the spirit world, you are pushing back the forces of darkness when you say, how great thou art. If you will go before the Lord, lay those problems before the altar of grace. Jesus came before the altar, which is the cross, symbolic of every altar, and He laid it down for you and I. Go to Him right now. Those of you that are, you're aching and you've been lied to, you've been kicked, you've got people in your life that are telling you there's no hope. There's no hope. But I'm telling you right now, He is our blessed hope. He is our blessed hope this morning. Just reach out and touch the Lord. Come on. Come on. Let's just praise Him this morning, church. God's wanting to do something for His children this morning, and we'll just praise Him. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I know some wonder, consider all the works Thy hands have made. I see the storm, I hear the rolling thunder, Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my soul, my Savior, God to thee.
Come to reached out to us and comes visit with us. There's been a lot of water on the bridge, but what we all want to do is just serve the Lord.
Amen.
We can serve the Lord. Come on. That's the desire of my heart. And when I'm not going to church somewhere, my life's not complete.
Amen.
That's got to happen. Amen.
That's it, brother. Y'all help me with this song. This old song called My Desire. Y'all know that. It's my desire.
Take this world
Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
In the prayer.
I want to do it. that's this evening, but if y'all got anybody that needs to come hear a message, I'm telling everybody, listen, if you don't hear the one message this year, you need to hear what God's giving. I don't care if you got a Bible, suit of clothes, pay for a haircut, whatever the excuse they got to get here. If you got somebody on your mind, I don't care if it's a husband, a wife, a kid, a friend, February the 6th, they need to be here to hear what God's got to say. Because I'm going to tell you, if I preach what God's given me and the way He's given it to me, the only mistake they're going to make, I'm going to go ahead and tell you before you get here, is you won't leave here like you came. You won't be able to stand this. You may leave out of here and not surrender your life with the Lord, but one thing about it, you won't be able to stand before the God Almighty and tell Him you didn't hear the word. Yes. You didn't know. So if the Lord puts somebody on y'all's heart, and we got 2 week notice, not that we don't need them here every Sunday. Yeah. I'm just telling you what the Lord's given me, and people need to be here to hear. If that's the only sermon they get all year, that's the one they're going to need to hear. And I give the Lord the praise and the glory for that opportunity. Yes.
Isn't God good? Isn't God good? Isn't God good? Brother Fletcher pointed out a few moments ago, David said, Lord, take not thy Holy Spirit from me.
Yes.
I know sometimes the church world will call us Pentecostals a little emotional. That's okay. But, as that song says, if you knew where He brought me from.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. And where I am today.
Yeah.
Oh, glory to God. When the Holy Spirit begins to reveal to you the worth, the power, and the glory of your salvation, yeah, it makes you want to shout. Yeah. And when He starts to give us just a pinprick, just a little glimpse, if you will, into eternity with God, when you see heaven, when you see the glory, when you see the portals of glory, it is real reality in your heart. I'm not talking about carnal. I'm talking about deep within your spirit. And you begin to study the book of Revelation. And you see the majesty and the glory and the grandeur of heaven. But without God, it's nothing.
Amen.
Just like this building without God is nothing. Amen. I thank Him this morning for His precious, precious spirit. When you go to a restaurant, you expect to be fed. But they ain't going to force feed you. They're not going to make you open up your mouth and take and partake. That's your free will. Same way when you come before the Lord. The Lord is saying, I prepared it. I paid the price at Calvary for you. I shed my blood. I came from heaven. I came down to earth to take your sin, my sin, from me upon His brow and His back. And He bled and paid the ultimate price of what? Love. Love. Love is what set you free. Love is what brought you off the cross. Love is what is going to get you home by the power of the Spirit. Love Him this morning, and I thank Him. As Brother Earl was talking about this morning before church, the Lord's dealing with me on the same thing this week. What you said was confirmation, by the way. Brother Earl was over here getting some stuff ready to put the Sunday school room and kind of break up some of the chairs and tables. And he said, God's going to fill this place. God's going to fill this place. Let me tell you something, church, like the brother testified. If I'm going to go work on something, now God's not limited like I am. But God will work through man. God will allow us to partake in His blessings, to get closer to Him, to be used for His glory. Yes. That's what He means by the tool shed. Oh. I don't go work on my tractor without tools, do you? I don't go work on my house without a wrench. My case, duct tape a lot of times. You're not supposed to amen so quick. But seriously. used for his glory. Oh, and how humbling is that? How sweet is that? How joyful is that to be able to be used of God? People are watching. People are watching. Brother, you said God's going to fill this place. I don't know if it's physically going to be like sardines in here. I don't know. I don't know if that bigger building is going to be built or not. But I know people are watching. Because I've got some testimonies to give you in a few minutes. But I know that signal is going out to several homes in Texas, a home in Alabama, a home in Washington State today. I don't know about others, but I know about those, what, three states in particular. And God is moving on their heart, church. Let's open up the Word of God this morning. Worship Him through the bread of life, His Word. If you would turn with me, and you don't have to stand this morning, I'm going to read quite a few verses from the book of Numbers. The Old Testament book of Numbers, written by Moses under the inspiration, of course, and authority of the Holy Spirit. We'll begin reading Numbers chapter 13 in verse 23. Numbers chapter 13 in verse 23. Hallelujah. Numbers chapter 13 and verse 23. You haven't said amen.
Amen.
And they came down into the brook of Eshcol and cut down from hence a branch with one cluster of grapes, and they bore it between two open a staff. And they brought of the pomegranates and of the figs. And the place was called the Brook Eshcol because of the cluster of grapes which the children of Israel cut down from hence. And they returned from searching of the land after 40 days. And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh, and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation, and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told him and said, "We came into the land where you sent us, and surely it flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. Nevertheless, the people be strong who dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites, and the Jebusites, and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan." And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, "Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it." But the men who went up with him said, "We are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we." And they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, "The land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eats up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw in it are the men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Enoch, which come of the giants, and were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And so we were in their sight." And I want to use for a subject this morning, preach in a few minutes, the language faith. The language of faith. Heavenly Father, we love you. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we adore you. Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus for the anointing of thy Spirit on everyone gathered here and all those that are watching. For without the Spirit that bears witness truth, as He is truth, we will not understand. We will not take it to heart. And I ask for the Holy Spirit, the teacher, the one called beside another to help in the time of need. We need you, Lord. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. We come before the throne of grace, Lord. We surrender everything unto thee at this hour. We ask, Lord, in Jesus' name, and all of God's children said, amen and amen. The language of faith. Church, in the world that we live in today, matter of fact, I would say it's been that way since God created the first family. There has been a situation that we just read about here in the book of Numbers. It's called unbelief. And even though God makes promises, as we just read here together, there is a faction that came together that would not believe. And church, when we have a language of faith, the opposite is unbelief. You see, one speaks life. Life is Christ. Life is the Spirit. Life is God. God is the Creator. He's the one that emanates. He illuminates. He is the Creator. But there is an opposite side, church. There is death. And so either we're speaking life or death. There's one or the other. We either alive or we're dead. You see. And there's too many today because of situations in the world in which we live in. And it's not new today. But it is progressively getting worse because man is more interconnected than he ever has been. In other words, we've got these gadget phones that are very intelligent. I mean, 30 years ago, forget it. The computers of today, digital technology, can move through the ether waves very, very quickly. Therefore, the exchange of ideas, thoughts, statements can flow from around the world to your doorstep, just like that. And so, is it going? Are we hearing about God? Are we looking to God? Are we looking to man? Are we listening to everything under the sun other than the Word of God? You see, as the children of God, there's nothing that can happen to me or you without Him okaying it.
Amen.
Read a book of Job. Sometimes we can step out and not be obedient. Things can get a little rough. But if we are doing our best by faith, living for the Lord, the Holy Spirit, if our faith is in Christ, what He did at Calvary, the blood, the Holy Spirit will help us in this resurrected life. We are a brand new creation in Christ Jesus. And I want to read some examples of life and death to you today that are going on or has gone on in the world. This comes from the Catholic News Agency. And this was in the news just recently in multiple, I don't know if any of the major outlets picked this up, but I get a lot of different news from around the world through different sources. This happens to do with a country that's a democracy, and they're supposed to be called Finland. And Finland, I will read this very quickly, a former minister, not minister as in a pulpit minister, but a government minister. She is a former government minister, and she is facing up to 2 years in jail, prison. 2 years. What was her crime, her alleged crime? She tweeted a Bible verse. This better stir our heart this morning. Don't think you can't act. She tweeted a Bible verse. And it was simply a verse regarding God created man and woman. And then she would quote the book of Romans chapter 1. Why did she do this? Because her church, let me make sure I read this right because I don't want to offend anybody. I'm probably going to offend you, but I don't mean to. church is the Evangelical Lutheran Church of Finland. And her church helped sponsor a homosexual pride event. So what she did, she did not confront the lifestyle of homosexuals. Understand what she tweeted. She went to the pastor and the elders of the church, or the powers that be, if you will, of the Lutheran church, and said, what you're doing doesn't seem to be aligning with the Word of God. And I'm paraphrasing, but that's essentially what this dear sister wrote. The authorities in Finland told her that she had now participated in hate speech. Hate speech. And that she was trying to cause defamation of character and incite a riot within the country. Now she's facing, she goes to court this week, 2 years in prison. She is speaking life, church. She is speaking the Word of God, which is life. It's truth. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. There is no life outside of Christ. She is quoting the Word of God for all to hear. And yet, the pushback, and I'm sure I'm going to get pushback, is death. I'm going to say it again. To die without God is an eternal death. It is a damnation of the soul and spirit of a man that will burn forever. Can I get an amen in the house?
Amen.
I don't like it. I have to preach that way. Say those things. I don't think any preacher really enjoys preaching on sin. But that is the problem today. And if it's going to be fixed, it has to be confronted, it has to be preached, it has to be sung about, but the solution is the blood of Jesus, the forgiveness of God Almighty, that will cleanse every sin, every stain, will break every chain, will melt that chain away, will throw away the stumbling block. And my heart and prayers go with you, my dear sister. God is able.
Amen.
I say no to the 2 years in Jesus' name. I speak life to this dear sister. If she proclaims the gospel of Jesus Christ, that is the answer and only answer, that the Word of God is the standard and anything else is baloney, that this is the standard which is God in His righteousness, you stand for that. Greater is He that is in you than He that is in the world. I believe that because my Word of God tells me that this morning. I want to speak to you about life here for a minute. This is one of things that I enjoy. Not like I used to. I used to be a fool for football. I did. I grew up in Dallas-Fort Worth, and I was one of the biggest Dallas Cowboy fans you've ever seen. I don't watch it near like I used to, and I'm in semi-retirement. I got better things to do. It's the Lord's business. Amen?
Amen.
But I still enjoy the competition. I enjoy the training. I enjoy it. I don't like when I see them acting a fool and some of their protests and everything. But even in the midst of people going to entertainment, 80, 100,000, whatever it be, college, pro, whatever. There is a remnant, Brother Fletcher. There is a remnant, Sister Marion, that loves God.
Amen. Yeah.
I'm going to give you an example of life. This was last week, Cincinnati, Ohio. I've been there. It's right on the edge of the northern side of Kentucky. Paul Brown Stadium. Legendary coach. And now they're in the playoffs. They're going against the dreaded Oakland Raiders. And people are lining up outside of Paul Brown Stadium at the ticket counter. They're getting ready to go in the stadium. A of a sudden, Grandpa falls and goes down. He's so happy to be able to go see an NFL football game. Down he went. It wasn't just him falling, it's the way he fell. His grandson knew something was wrong. Everybody's looking around. Have you seen videos of people that were dead on the street or dying on the street or getting kicked and beat up and everybody just walking by? Mm-hmm. Not doing nothing? I know you have. I've seen it a couple different times on video in Chicago and New York City. That's the way it was here. But people were fearful. You know, oh, it's COVID. Oh, I can't. You know, we can get a little fearful. Panic, don't know what to do. Nobody could help that man. The grandson's there holding his grandpa. Oh, but God filled us. A man, one man, drove while I filled this church. He lives in Dallas, Texas. But he grew up in Ohio. He's a nurse in an emergency center in Dallas, Texas. Woo! He got a ticket. So he drove from Dallas, Texas to Cincinnati, Ohio. He was several feet away. What's going on? He finally looked through and saw that man down. He rushed to him. You know, people are like, what's this? A seizure? It's a seizure. He'll come out of it. He checked. There was no pulse. There's no life. Yeah. No pulse. There's no life. We got no flow of blood. Life of the flesh is in the blood. We've got nothing being pumped. There's no pulse. He immediately began to do CPR. Oh, but God's got somebody else, you see. The lady saw this man do it. Woof of that. She went knelt inside him. Oh, and began to pray. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. He laid down, was breathing life, air, oxygen into the lungs of this man that had no pulse. Did the chest compressions in a few minutes. I'm sorry, less than a minute. Pulse came back. Glory to God. They got him to the hospital, and he's alive today. Why? God Almighty, the giver of life. You see, this man jumped into action. You say, well, he's trained that way. He's a nurse. God had him there, come from Dallas, Texas, all the way up there to bring life into that man. I believe it. In fact, merciful God.
Yes, he is.
Glory to God. Oh, what a merciful God. And the nurse that breathed life into him. Woo! You know what he said? God, hadn't he come here for a time such as this? Glory to God. He didn't say it with my training. He was a former firefighter, by the way. That's where he grew up in Ohio. I said that a few moments ago. He was a firefighter, EMS type guy. Then he went to Dallas, emergency room nurse. He didn't say, I want to thank my schooling or my education or my bosses or my intellect. He said, God had me come here for a time such as this. Breathe life into that man. Church. Life and death is in the power of the tongue.
Amen.
Glory to God. No, I don't mean blab and grab it. I'm not that type of preacher. Name it, claim it, whatever. No. Everything's got to be predicated on the will of Almighty God. That's why He's Almighty. He's the one. It's His will. But morning, they saw it. The 12 spies. But there's a difference between the 10 and the 2. They brought back what? The pomegranates. They brought back the olives. And whatever else it was, the date or whatever. Thank you. I know there's a bountiful harvest that God said, I'm going to give you a land flowing with milk and honey. I'm going to give it to you. You just got to go possess it. You just got to go possess it. But they got their eyes off the promises of God.
Amen.
Number one. Number two, they had forgotten all the miracles that got them out of Egypt, out of bondage, out of slavery.
Right.
Across the Red Sea. Here they go into the wilderness. God did that on purpose. He could have had directed them a direct route to the Jordan River. But God took them the long way away. Why? Why sometimes are we in a wilderness and we're like, I don't understand. God knows you and I better than we know ourselves.
That's right.
And not only us, but our families. Everyone that you come in contact with. Everyone that is watching you. The Lord sometimes will allow us to go in this wilderness. And we don't know what to do. That's what they did. They were in the wilderness. But here comes the Lord. It's our promise right there. Canaan. Beautiful land of Canaan. They got their mind off God. They started looking at the enemy. They started looking at even though the fruit was there. How many times in your life has God showed you fruit? How many times? Church, if you're honest, He shows it to you every day. He shows it to you every day. You're getting closer to the Lord. Somebody's talking about preaching or talking to somebody. A tool is when it's used properly. And He always uses it properly. We're the ones that want to try to slip out of the hand. But if we don't, if we stay firmly secure in His hand, He will turn it, use us just in the right time, the right force, the right nurturing, whatever the situation calls for, in dates and pomegranates and olives will come.
Amen.
Because God said so. Not me. But God said so. It may not look like it. We may be going through a wilderness experience. But here we have a situation of God sustaining them with manna from heaven, taking the bitter waters of Marah, making it sweet through what a tree, symbolizing the cross, as time had shown the cross. God, their shoes didn't wear, their clothes didn't wear, and there wasn't a feeble one among them. They took the spoils of Egypt with them. God is a blessing God. But they again, they got their eyes. Oh, started looking at the enemy. It's easy to do, church, if we get our eyes off the Lord. You remember Peter walking on the water? We all read that story many times. As long as he kept his eyes on the Lord, he walked on that water just fine. But when he started looking at the waves, the storm, the clouds, the darkness, he began to sink. And that's exactly this example that we're dealing with here today. Life or death. These 10 came back, stirred up the congregation with death. We are grasshoppers. These are giants. We cannot defeat them. Even though God said, go up and possess it. You know something God didn't say? God didn't say, go up and conquer it. But you go, oh, there's a spiritual lesson here.
Amen.
God doesn't tell you to go conquer nothing because He conquered death, hell, and the grave. He conquered Satan.
Yeah.
He conquered it. He conquered it. Our job is to take a hold of that gift. Take a hold of that gift and possess it, church. Possess it. another example of life and death. That little camera. I got a phone call or a text from a lady in Washington State. Try to give this story and not cry. Her husband is incarcerated in Alaska. He is a cellmate of the first brother that got in touch with me when he found my name and number on the Swaggart's Evangelist magazine. And she originally texted me to thank me, et cetera, and that, you know, where we live, by the way, the reception ain't that great. I've told you that. Sometimes I miss phone calls. And then she was, you know, making sure everything's okay, et cetera, and just letting me know that her husband and his cellmate were wanting to talk to me. So I began to start dialogue with her, and then I passed it off to my wife in a day or so. And I felt the unction of the Spirit to get off the pew, take it further. Take it further. Like that man went, kneeled, breathed life into a lifeless man with no pulse. Lord, deal with me. Talk with her. So I did. She sent me in this church a Christmas card after the first conversation. Jesus, and as long as I got Jesus, I'm going to make it. she has been shunned by the so-called church. She says the church will not have anything to do with her. Why? Haven't we all sinned and fell short of the glory of God?
Yeah.
My Bible tells me that in Romans 3:23. They won't have anything to do with her self-righteousness. She did. She told me, she said, I've never been treated so badly by people that call themselves believers. Church. Without forgiveness, there's no life.
Amen.
Faith is what steps up. Faith is what comes forward and says, Lord, I believe in you. I believe in what you did for me. And anybody that whosoever will come forward and say, oh Lord, forgive me, a sinner. You were my Savior. You did it for me. My Savior. My Jesus, my Savior. I can't believe that churches would do that to somebody that will say, how can we as children of God not welcome every eternal soul? And if they're doing their best to say, hey, that's what her husband was crying out. I talked to him. I've quizzed him a little bit. He knows the word of God. And I can tell the anointing on the phone in his voice, I know. And so. You see, she didn't want anything from us. She gave. She gave. She's retired in her 60s. She gave because she felt the Holy Spirit touch her. All the way from little old country USA, Louisiana, all the way to country Northwest Washington. Don't limit God. I have done that too much in my life. If we will step back, allow God to pick us up to be a hammer if necessary, a screwdriver, or a Kleenex. Still a tool to wipe somebody's eye. A blanket to wrap them in love. Warmth, comfort. To let them know Jesus loves you. I want you to know, Diane, this church loves you.
Amen.
This church is praying for you and your husband and anyone at all that's alive. Why? They've got an eternal soul, and it's either going to go to heaven or it's going to go to hell. I've got to hurry. So now we have the 10 and the 2. Whose report are you going to believe? Whose report am I going to believe? God is looking for men and women like that man and woman in Cincinnati, Ohio, that took the stand that says, I will speak life. I will speak faith unto you. I will be God's tool, bending over to do what I can. Prayer and action, whatever God calls us to do. Isn't that what Caleb and Joshua did? Mm-mm. They came back. But they didn't look see that Caleb and Joshua rent their clothes in front of the congregation. That was a show Brother Fletcher was saying earlier about humility and being humble. Back then it was sackcloth and ashes, or you would rent your clothes. It's saying, no, whoa, stop. Stop, listen to me. No, we can't do this. You cannot defy God this way. God has promised things to us. We can't do this. In other words, you're calling God a liar. God said, but our eyes see this. So, congregation, we can't do it. We cannot take the land of milk and honey, even though God had provided for them. Over and over and over. Forgot all the miracles. But the main thing they forgot, see, sometimes we can forget about miracles. We can. That's the way we're wired. People say, well, you showed me, I believe. Okay. How many times has God showed you things in the past? You see. One thing, you see, that they forgot, the main thing that they forgot is what delivered them out of Egypt. It was the slain lamb. It was the slain lamb that they would take as the angel of the Lord would pass by, the angel of death. They applied the blood to the doorpost and the header. They would consume the lamb. That's what brought them out, church. That was God giving them a type and shadow that you and I have today of the new covenant. The Lord brought us out. Glory to God. He saved our soul. And now, they forgot, though, what brought them out. God was implementing the Levitical sacrificial system with them, installing the law, trying to get them in the wilderness to where he could bring them away from the world so they would depend on him and he could show them his nature. And then we get closer to God is what he had to do. And yet, every man over 20 years of age died. Approximately 40 years. Later, a total of 40 years. They spent 40 days, the Bible says, 40 days. them. Mercy after mercy. I have provided. I am Jehovah Jireh. I am their provider. And yet, they're murmuring, saying they want to go back to Egypt. They want to go back to bondage. They want to go back and be a slave after everything I've done for them. I showed them the grapes, the pomegranates, the dates. It's right there. It's right there. I'll show it to them. And yet, you know.
more. It can be a little rough. Be a little coarse. But I can relate to it. He knew it was real. It was the Holy Spirit. Yeah. It was not holier than thou. It's all good. I've done the same thing you have. I looked right at him and said, I'm no different. Except the blood has washed it away.
Yes, amen. Right.
The blood has washed it away. That's the only difference. And God has brought him to a place, or allowed him to come to a place, where he will look up and cry out, oh God. He began to get. He began to say, you know, I used to thought that I was real lucky in life. He said, but I see now, I was blessed all the time.
Amen.
That's faith starting to rise up, Brother Ronnie.
Yeah.
Faith starting to rise up, Brother Clayton. Faith coming out. I've been blessed this whole time.
Right.
And I did pray with him. Lord willing, I'm going to see him tomorrow. I'm not going to stop. By the grace of God. But you said something. You won't leave here like you came. Let me tell you. When I left there, he wasn't the same man.
Lord,
yeah.
Lord, yeah.
He wasn't. It had nothing to do with me. It was the Spirit of Almighty God touching him. It's the Spirit that can draw out that emotion in the hardest of hearts. The hard man can be melted by the Spirit of Almighty God. And I thank the Lord for that, that we went from a situation of unbelief. Of unbelief to belief. The Lord would say to Moses, and the Lord said, I have pardoned according to your word. In other words, the prayer of Moses. No, we can't save them. We can't save ourselves. It's all by the blood. But I'm going to tell you again, there is a language of faith that God honors. If it's coming from the heart, as long as it's not just a bunch of hot air, as long as we're coming out, Lord, only you can do this. You and you alone. Watch God move. The Lord would say, regarding Caleb, Lord would say in the 24th verse, but my servant Caleb, because he had another spirit with him, in other words, my spirit, and has followed me fully, him will I bring into the land whereinto he went, and his seed shall possess it. Church, Caleb and Joshua believe God. Just like Abraham believed God, just like Paul believed God, just like Peter, James, and John believed God. They weren't perfect men. There's not been a perfect man at all except the man Christ Jesus. But what are we speaking from our lips as I close today? What are we speaking to those that are hurting? What are we speaking in our own situation? Let's start here. Let's start with self here. What are we speaking in our own situation?
The Lord may have you take a stand in a different way than me, or vice versa. In other words, there's different tools in the toolbox. One tool might not be quite right for a particular job the Lord needs us to do. But I know this. It all comes together for His glory. Amen. It all comes together for His glory. As the brother begins to play, I want us to go before the Lord. By faith, Lord, let everything that I speak be a language of faith. Everything, when somebody talks to me, and they bring the situation, whatever it is, those trials and tribulations, in my own situation. Lord, remember the man that his son was dying. He told the Lord, help my unbelief. You say, wait a minute now. He's saying, I've got unbelief. That was a prayer of faith in truth, saying, Lord, you can only help my unbelief. I can't do it. Only you can. And if there's any doubt, any unbelief whatsoever, He paid for it at Calvary to give you victory over that. And to give you victory in every area of our life. He paid it in full. And He wants, in as the church age is winding down, I believe, quickly, I want to see His glory. I want to see that harvest, Sister Marion. I want to see it. Yes. I want to see it. All the prayers that you've been praying for, brother, I want to see God. I want to see God. I want to see He gets the glory. Not you and me. We can't do anything. But the tool is just laying there saying, God, you know the desires of my heart. He said, I'll give you the desires of your heart. That's His words. As long as they align with His will. Lord, save them. Lord, heal that sickness. Lord, let no one get left behind. Lord, bring that harvest into your barn. Bring it into the barn, whether it's in Washington, Monroe, or wherever it's at. Bring the harvest home. And when you say it, you pray it. Because He has given us so much fruit in the past. I guarantee it. Just like you did with Elisha. I believe in my heart it's going to be a great harvest. It is going to be a great harvest in the lateness of this hour. Let's pray.
I could do nothing.
Reach out and touch Him, church. Reach out and touch Him. Reach out and touch Him.
Without Him.
Reach out and touch Him.
I surely fail.
Reach out and touch Him. Have that language of faith in your heart.
Without Him. I
we're going to proclaim. Yes, Lord. Yes. Do it again, Lord. Catherine Coleman would say, oh, Lord, do it again. Do it again, Lord. Do it again. Do it again, Lord. Do it again.
Without Him,
Texas, Alabama.